Welcome to the second of three lectures on the Logic Lab. This lecture is concerned with the specification of logics in the Logic Lab, and it presupposes some knowledge of sequent calculus and Shen. If you want to brush up on your background, I recommend viewing the video Programming in Shen, Sequent Calculus and Metaprogramming in the Learn section of the Shen website. Look under the title Presentations. The material you need to understand is covered from 4 minutes 50 to 15 minutes 27. You also want to download the Logic Lab from the Shen site. A logic L has the following components: a syntax determining the type of propositions or props of L, a set of derivation rules that determine what is provable in L, possibly a semantics which determines the set of legitimate interpretations of L props, and a pragmatics or a body of expertise concerning how to solve problems in that logic. Now, not all logics have these components. For example, prior to Kripke's work on possible world semantics, modal logic existed without a semantics. The Logic Lab deals with components 1, 2, and 4. Syntax and derivation rules are connected in the sense that the derivation rules must obey the syntax rules in 1, so we'll be using type checking in Shen to ensure this is so. To begin to illustrate the Logic Lab, we will start with propositional calculus, which is assumed to be common knowledge here. The first step is to define the syntax of our logic. Let us begin then with the familiar, starting with the syntax of propositional calculus. An atomic proposition as a symbol, conventionally P, Q, R, etc., will allow any symbol that is not a logical constant to serve as an atomic proposition. The logical constants are listed here, and if P is a prop, so are any of the following. Now, some of the conventional symbols are not ASCII keyboard characters, so we'll use the composite symbols as replacements. Defining the syntax now requires defining the data type prop in Shen. Our first rule states that we can deduce P as a prop if we can deduce that P is a symbol, which is not a logical constant. The second rule states that not P is a prop, just when P is a prop. And the third rule deals with the binary connectives PCQ is a prop, just when C is a logical connective and P and Q are props. The double underlines just abbreviate two rules, so that this rule is just short for these two rules. Let's test these rules. This list structure, which we read as P implies Q, is overloaded. It is a prop and also a list of symbols. If we want to test to see if it is a prop, we have to enter the expression together with type prop. There are many derivation systems for propositional calculus. We'll use the one from logic proof and computation, which we call LPC. First, the left-right rules for the logical connectives. These are fairly straightforward. The rule of implies right says we can prove P implies Q by assuming P and proving for Q. The rule of implies left says that if P implies Q is an assumption and proving for Q, then we could do so by proving P. The AND left and AND right rules split a conjunction into its component parts. OR right 1 says that we can prove P or Q by proving P. OR right 2 says we can prove P or Q by proving Q. And OR left is a proof by cases. And the next two rules explicate the meaning of two-way implication. The final rules define negation. Not P is defined as P implies falsum, where falsum is any absurdity, for example, 1 equals 0. Second, two structural rules. The first allows us to weaken a list of assumptions, and the second to change their order. Finally, a group of rules not dealing with connectives. Adding hype and lemma creates the minimal propositional calculus. Hype is, of course, proof by hypothesis, and lemma is a close cousin of the cut rule. It allows us to pose an arbitrary prop as a lemma, which, if proved, becomes an extra assumption. Adding the principle of explosion creates the intuitionistic propositional calculus, and adding the law of the excluded middle creates full classical propositional calculus. The most basic rule of LPC states that a prop can be proved if it's an assumption. The double greater than sign is the Chen-Askew substitute for turnstile. Let's look at the structure of this rule, which is in the main in the form of an orthodox Chen sequent calculus rule. The word D-rule signifies that we are introducing a derivation rule. The hype gives the name of this rule. For convenience, we shorten the classical names of our derivation rules. The parentheses give the parameters to this rule, and since the contents are empty, we can conclude that this is an unparameterized rule. What follows is an orthodox Chen notation for sequent calculus derivation rules. If we enter a derivation rule with type checking enabled, which does not conform to the syntax for propositional calculus as defined, that is, it doesn't trade in props like this, then a type error is raised. Thus, it's required that derivation rules operate on props as defined. Now, in short order, let us list the other unparameterized derivation rules. You can see they follow exactly the design and layout of the rules that we have hitherto described. We want to move to examine derivation rules which accept parameters. A basic example of this is the rule of the law of excluded middle, which allows the entry of P or not P at any stage of a proof for any value of P. An initial attempt is this, but this fails. Unlike the Chen type checker, the logic lab does not accept derivation rules that are synthetic. That is to say, derivation rules in which there are variables in the premises which are not found in the conclusion or defined in side conditions or cited as parameters. The basis for this is that derivation rules are macros which generate Chen functions, and the variable occurrence restriction, that rules cannot generate new unbound variables, is basic to Chen. So in conducting proofs using LEM, we must expect to provide a value for P to say what it is. Therefore, P is provided as a parameter. Moreover, the type of P has to be specified, and here it is obviously prop, and so here is the correct rendition. The structural rules are more complex because they require parameters and side conditions to elucidate them. The thinning rule allows us to supply a positive integer n as a parameter and remove the nth assumption. Therefore, the thinning rule is coded by first specifying that a numeric parameter n has been passed, and then stating in a side condition that the nth proposition is to be removed from the list of assumptions using a contrivance. Now, the contrivance is that the variable hypothesis is reserved for the list of hypotheses. So it's a kind of hook which we can redefine for our purpose. And so here is the rule for thinning. So all we've said, very simply, is that in the thinning rule, we are allowed to enter a number which indexes some proposition or hypothesis and allows us to remove it. And here the innermost bounding for hypotheses created by a side condition, operates in the construction of the output. The nth prop is removed from the list of hypotheses. Now, of course, remove nth needs to be defined for this derivation rule to type check, and here it is. And finally, the rule swap exchanges the position of two assumptions and therefore carries two parameters. I'm not going to give the coding for exchange in this lecture, which is very much an exercise for you to experiment with in writing Shen programs. If we inquire after the type status of a derivation rule, Shen informs us that it advances a valid proof by producing a valid proof. The type valid is defined in terms of the functions that advance a proof. But an object of type valid is also an actual concrete data structure. That is, it's a list of sequence. A sequence is a pair composed of a list of props, the assumptions, and a prop, the conclusion to be proved. In saying that an object of type valid is also a list of sequence, we are not saying that every function that maps a list of sequence to a list of sequence is valid. We are just affirming the following rule. The importance of this rule is that we can use it to dissect the state of a valid object by looking at the internal structure of that object as a concrete data structure. We can then use the results of that inspection to program the computer to apply selected valid derivation rules. These programs are called tactics, and they are functions of the type valid goes to valid. Let's show this by creating a tactic called indirect proof. Indirect proof, as you know, is a method of proving P by assuming not P prior to proving a contradiction. Suppose the sequence to be solved is of the form delta P. In the system, in logic proof and computation, this chain of steps performs indirect proof. First, assume P or not P using LEM, the law of the excluded middle. Use OR left for a proof by cases. By hypothesis, you can prove P from P. You're left with the original problem with not P as an extra assumption. Now, here is the code. Notice how it takes advantage of the knowledge that a valid object is also a concrete data structure, namely a list of sequence. A derivation rule has been represented so far as a function, implying that such a rule is unambiguously applicable to any problem to derive at most one result. However, this is not true of non-deterministic rules which can be applied to derive more than one result. The derivation rule implies left is one, such that if it's applied to the sequence shown here, either one of two results can be legally derived. So a derivation rule really defines a relation over developing proofs, which in some cases, but not all, has the characteristics of a function. In treating a relation as a function, we are performing what is called in logic programming committed choice indeterminism. That is, we are simply choosing one alternative and ignoring the rest. In some cases, choosing the wrong solution means the difference between completing the proof successfully and failing. In a logic lab, when a derivation rule is entered, it is defined in terms of a help function that can actually collect all these solutions if required. The help function is named after the name n of the derivation rule by appending the dollars to the name n. The derivation rule n uses this help function but does not return all solutions but only this first solution found. We can, however, descend, if needed, to the help function if we want to collect all solutions. For example, the implies left function is defined in terms of a function implies left dollars. If we ask for the signature of implies left dollars in the top level, we get this response. The help function takes a Boolean flag which determines whether all solutions are found or just one. If the argument is true, then ImpliesLeftDollars returns the list containing all solutions found. If the argument is false, then a unit list containing the first solution found is returned. And if the help function ImpliesLeftDollars fails to advance a valid proof, the empty list of valid continuations is returned. Our top-level function ImpliesLeft simply calls this function with false flagged and takes the first solution found, returning the original problem if no solutions are to be got. And here is the definition. Well, that concludes the second talk on the Logic Lab. I hope you've enjoyed this presentation. In the next talk, we'll look at the General Proof Assistant and how to use derivation rules and tactics to build proofs.